Welcome everybody. Thank you for being here at this webinar with me, the security chapter leader of ING Belgium. A small introduction of myself. I am Glenn ten Katen. I am active in the world of security for more than 10 years. I started my career when I was like around 13 years old, playing a lot of Unreal tournaments and gaming, and you know the drill, how we all start our IT career. And basically I got a bit bored with that, you know, only playing games, so I started to investigate more. You know, you had these aimbotters and hackers online who could cheat and had automated systems for shooting people. Basically, I joined them, built my own aimbot when I was 13 years old, and yeah, that is really when my hacking career started. Of course, I used this knowledge over the years. I gathered for good, and now I teach people. Do a lot of penetration testing, mobile security, web application. I'm very familiar with the whole DevSecOps. I'm also a software development trainer, co-founder of DevDev, and also one of the co-authors together with my brother of an open source project. It's called OWASP, the Security Knowledge Framework. You know, I want really to use all the knowledge we gathered over the years, and we put it in this presentation to, you know, really help you guys. Because especially in the certain period in this time where we are, and when we call DevSecOps or SecDevOps, or we're talking about the new way of working, it is quite a challenge for the developers, you know, how to approach certain things, because there are a lot of pitfalls and problems that are laying around the corner to get to the next step of software development. So I want to go into the depth, and I want to ask you guys, when we talk about DevOps, yeah, we talk about being agile, being quick, that you have velocity, that the developer have more responsibilities. It's not only developing, but it's also knowing the whole stack and how to configure it and patch management. And, you know, so the developer still gets more and more responsibilities, so he's able to be, you know, released faster. Also, if you look at the whole infrastructure part and the configuration management, you know, it's all starting to be code. Yeah, so software, it's going to be code. All, everything is going to be code. Nowadays, you build with Terraform, your whole network stack, your whole network surface. And how do you do it? With software. So those are already kind of challenges for the DevOps. But now, of course, you know, we have a couple of challenges with SecDevOps. I want to ask you guys, what do you think about the challenge the new SecDevOps persons have? Because there are a lot of those. And the big challenge that currently have is, you know, all these new technologies and new things they have to consider. You know, that's already hard, those new technologies to learn. But of course, there's always that problematic thing called security. The true challenge of SecDevOps is how to implement security in your DevOps way of working, where we have a software development lifecycle that can technically, you know, you can technically release maybe 10, 20 times a day. But how do you implement security in that? So what I want to do is I want to, in this webinar, go through the whole software development lifecycle, pointing out that what you should and already have implemented, that it works really well. But on the moment that you have like 10 or 20 releases a day, or maybe a couple of releases a day, you are stuck because you cannot do the security part in the SecDevOps way of working. So I'm going to show you guys, explain what the pitfalls are of this software development lifecycle. Yeah, and also show you what the correct path is to follow to, you know, improve this challenge that we have and counter it. So when we talk about secure software development lifecycle, we start first with the basics, you know, where it all starts, the requirements. And of course, I'm a security guy, so I will focus very much on the security part of the software development lifecycle. Like you have your non-functional requirements, your functional requirements and whatnot. But of course, every software development lifecycle, should start with security requirements. So what type of security requirements is being pushed from the company you work at. I hear a lot of times developers saying, you know, there are no real requirements from a security point of view, you know. And that is also when, for example, there's a penetration test being done or a secure code review being done, that those things will pop up. You can see that the quality of the product is not that well because of no security requirements being used up front. So it's a big impact if you don't have those. Some of the companies, they do have something, but it's a very minimalistic thing and not really adding, you know, the in-depth quality that we would like to have from a security point of view. When we talk about software development lifecycle, of course, there's test automation as well. Everything is automated and test codes written for it, specifically for the code quality of the project. So think about unit testing, think about the code quality of the commits. So how complex is the code? Is there any dead end code? Stuff like that. So that also adds to the whole quality and is normally also integrated in the whole software development lifecycle. And of course, we have the phase where we have the security test automation. So if you have your security requirements check, you use that standard, you implemented those requirements, so you're all good. Then you have your test automation for the code quality, so duplication, dead end code, complex code, all that stuff, it's in there. The unit testing, the end-to-end testing, the functional testing, you have all that done. Then it's the time that you would do the security test automation. And what we normally do, we have, like, you know, the static analytic security tooling and the dynamic security tooling that we will use. And of course, the final step is the manual verification, you know, especially when you talk about critical applications, that a penetration tester will go through the application and will do a penetration test to see if he can find any vulnerabilities. Because you can all have those nice security requirements, your test automation and whatnot, but still on the implementation fault, you know, in the implementation, there can still be a lot of room to still create vulnerabilities in our applications. So for critical stuff, the manual verification is, of course, a very important step. Let's zoom a bit more in on the type of tooling that we have from a security point of tool. Here we have a couple of vendors, you know, it's open source vendors, it's commercial vendors, it doesn't really matter. They're just different type of tooling that will look at the static code of the application. So what it basically does with different type of techniques, it will look at the source code of your application and will find possible vulnerabilities in that source code. Very useful, because some of the vulnerabilities you can only find when you are looking at the source code. That's why we have a static analyzing security tooling and a dynamic version. So here we have also a mixture where they really look at the source code and check the different methods that are being used, and if dangerous user input is put in those methods, that can then trigger and result into security vulnerabilities. But you also have tooling like the dependency checker that just checks the libraries that you're using and if that version of that library you're using has a known vulnerability. So very easy to use. It gives a quick result to you, and that's really nice. But for example, the other tooling, they really scan the code for dangerous methods that use user input that was straight away dumped into this dangerous method. So with this static analyzing security tooling approach, we can already find in an automatically way security vulnerabilities in our product using our software development lifecycle process. Like I mentioned, we have also the dynamic version. So what does that mean? That means the dynamic version that the application is in a running state. And in this running state, we can see how it actually behaves. And this is really important, because here we can find different type of vulnerabilities that we couldn't find with the source and the secure code review. So when only looking at the source code of the application. Here again, we have a mixture of open source tooling and commercial tooling that all can do this type of dynamic security scanning of your application. Of course, there's a sort of overlap, and that's all good, you know, between the two. There will be findings from one tool and then the other tool that have the same finding, but still there's a huge delta, I would say, between those. That with this one, the dynamic, you will also find different type of vulnerabilities than with this static code analyzing tooling. And now it's really important. I have a question for you guys. So I just explained very briefly like the two benefits and the type of security tooling that you want in your secure software development lifecycle. But let's say you use different type of SaaS tooling, yeah, static. You use different type of dynamic security tooling. What will exactly be covered? And what I mean with that, so let's say in a percentage, how many vulnerabilities, if 100% is finding all the vulnerabilities, how much percentage will be covered if I use different type of SaaS tooling, different type of DAS tooling in my software development lifecycle? The question and the answer, you will not expect it, but the answer on this question is around 20% of all the vulnerabilities will be covered, will be found when you use multiple SaaS and multiple DAS type of security tooling. So imagine only 20% of the vulnerabilities will be found. Because another thing that people don't realize, and you know, these type of tooling, they are great, you know, they add a really good extra value to your software development lifecycle, but it's a very thin safety net. And why I say very thin, because they only can find 20% of the vulnerabilities in your application. And you know, for example, a big example is business logic. No application, no security tool can test for business logic vulnerabilities. None. This is only doable by creating threat models, yeah, sitting with the team and really think about how you can abuse the business logic. No tool can do this. So again, a huge list of all the vulnerabilities that can occur on business logic level, and for example, authorization bypasses and stuff like that, can simply not be found by static or dynamic type of security tooling. So it's very important when you use these type of tooling that you are aware of the limitations that they have. That's all. I mean, they add value, but they have limitations, and you need to understand what the limitation is so you can fill this gap with other means, so you can close that gap and you know, get a higher coverage, be more secure. So here we have an example of a software development lifecycle where you would have those secure, those static and dynamic security type of tooling. So you have a project repository somewhere. It can be GitLab or GitHub, whatever. You know, when the developer pushes his contribution to the repository, it will be triggered by Jenkins. Jenkins will then, for example, launch a couple of Dockers where the security tooling is running in. In this example, you will see here, we have a Docker container that's kicking off a ZAP Docker. And that will perform a dynamic scan on the web application and will try all type of injections. When this ZAP Docker scan has finished its thing, it will just be removed. The Docker container will be killed. The metrics will be pushed then back to the defect dojo, and in defect dojo we can do our triage and we can see the vulnerabilities, and that's also the place where we will validate all the findings. And on the last moment, when we are sure we validated all the findings, then they will be pushed into a Jira or in whatever project ticket management system you use. So this is the classical, you know, secure software development lifecycle with a couple of tooling. All the tools, by the way, the Defect Dojo, the ZAP, and whatnot, they are all open source, so it's really easy to use. And you know, So this is like a basic approach that all the companies now are setting up and developing. And like I mentioned before, yes, it's awesome to do this, but there are some pitfalls, and I want to show you guys the pitfalls so you can learn from it and, you know, make the decision if you think this is the added value, if it brings really the added value you expect. Because a lot of the things, you know, what we're now going to talk about is really a struggle. So one of the pitfalls is this. Did you ever hear of false positives? Are you guys aware of it? What is that? What are false positives? So imagine you have an application, you put it into the next stage in the acceptance environment, you will run the dynamic version, dynamic security tool, the Zapdocker. It will scan your application for known vulnerabilities like cross-site scripting, SQL injection. It will push the metrics back to your vulnerability management system. In this example, this Defect Dojo. And now you have a list of a couple of hundred vulnerabilities listed there as findings. So now you, as a developer, have to go through all those findings and to determine if it was a true positive. So the tool has said this is a finding and it's indeed a correct finding. It's a valid finding, or to research and check if it's a false positive. And that means that, yes, the tool said it was a finding, but because the tool is not that smart, or the tool lacked context, or, you know, numbers of reasons, it can be a false positive. So it the tool said it was a positive finding, but in fact it's not. So this is very unfortunate that we have to really go through every finding to really see if it's a valid finding or not. So false positives. Everybody who work with security tooling or trying to implement those will come across those. And good thing is that OWASP also has a nice project for this to make this visible. So what they did is they created a project called the OWASP Workbench. Good question. The OWASP benchmark project. So good thing is OWASP created the project. It's called the OWASP. The good thing is OWASP, they created a project for this. It's the benchmark project, and in here they test and create a fair approach on how to interpret the results and the quality of the security tooling. So you have the dynamic tooling, the static tooling, and how well do they score. And they do that based on the amount of false positive rates and the amount of true positive rates. And as you can see, if the number on the right is really at 80% false positive rate, then it's basically worse than random. Or in the right top corner, it's reporting everything is vulnerable. So you can ask yourself if this tool is really adding value for me. Here we have the results of a couple of projects. So again, non-commercial projects and commercial projects. And as you can see, that some of those tooling, they are really high in the amount of false positives. The rate of false positives is so high that it's technically worse than guessing. And why is it so important? Why am I stressing out about this? Because if you have your software development lifecycle, yeah, and you put these type of security tooling in there, it's really awesome. Like I said, it will add a lot of value, but you need to be aware that it will also bring still a lot of work. And what do I mean with that? Because you still have to go through every finding that tool will generate. And for every time you run it, you have to go through the whole list again. So it will bring a lot of work and extra, you know, teams and stress on the teams to able to go through it. So yes, you can kick it off automatically in your pipeline, but somebody still has to check the results. The problem is also when you kick it off and you do it once and you have a couple of false positives in it, and you run the scan again on the next sprint, on the next iteration of your project, there's a high chance that those type of false positives will pop up again. So basically, what you also need to have in your secure software development lifecycle is a vulnerability management system. So in here, I have an example of this vulnerability management system. It's called Defect Dojo. It's an open source project, again, from OWASP. And here, you can do this. You can correlate and store all the findings that were being done when you kick off security scans. So let's say you scan your application. There's a number of vulnerabilities coming out of it. You can go through those vulnerabilities, like you can see here. Here, the scanner has found three vulnerabilities. And what you now can do in this vulnerability management system, you can say, I checked this version, I checked this vulnerability, and indeed, it seems that it's a true positive finding. So you can mark it as, okay, this is something as a real finding. I need to put this in my backlog to be able to fix it and improve it because there's a security issue. But some of those can also be false positives. So when you research every finding that the tool has came up with, you will check if it's a real finding, a true positive, or a false positive. And what is also the really added value of this type of vulnerability management system, that you can mark the findings that were a false positive. So that means when you do the scan next time of the next iteration of your project, it will not bring up again all those false positives, because you don't want to be bothered with those false positives, right? You only want to see the deltas of what has been changed and if it's then a true positive or a false positive. So to have a vulnerability management system in your development lifecycle is crucial. Otherwise, it will already not work because developers will get screaming, insane, going insane, because every time they have to go through a whole list and they know a big chunk of that list of those findings are all false positives. So what is then the added value for them to put so much effort and work into it and they gain so little? So to stress out, you need a vulnerability management system when you integrate security tooling in your software development lifecycle. As I mentioned, you can nicely verify, do your research, and to see if it's indeed a true positive, like a true finding you need to do something with and solve it, or that's a false positive. And as you can see, in this case, the Defect Dojo gives a nice overview of what the impact is, what the description is of the vulnerability that has been found. So you can do already a proper analysis. But, you know, now we talked a bit about all the security tooling and, you know, the automated ways that we can do. But again, somebody, in this case, the developer, has to look at it, has to interpret the results and to say, okay, is this a false positive or not? And now, like I mentioned in before, you know, I truly believe that the only person, yeah, who can solve the security issues are the developer. I truly believe the developer as a NAO. I hope, you know, as a IT people, that you all watch The Matrix, right? And in The Matrix, you had Neo, and Neo was the key figure. He was the one who could save the world. He was the one who could, you know, make it all better. And when I look at developers, I see there a Neo. I see a person who is really skilled with huge potential. And developers, this part is really for you guys. This is how you can make the change, you know, that needs to be happening in the software development world. Because every time, you know, I do a penetration test, I see the same stuff over and over again. That's why there's also the OWASP Top 10. And as you guys know, the OWASP Top 10 barely changes over the past 10 years. And why is that? Because there are so many mistakes with so many the same mistakes. And there's nowhere really the right information for the developers to really help them and guide them. So there's a lot of deja vu moments when I did security testing on applications. And you know what we then see is also that you know the developers, they really try their best to you know protect the application against hackers, but the reality is that they're really barely hanging on. They're barely hanging on. They are dodging bullets, but they forget they are NATO. They shouldn't dodge bullets. They have the potential to stop bullets and not to dodge. But reality is they are barely hanging on this moment. And, you know, my message to you guys is, please, there is an option. There's always an option. You just need to follow the white rabbit. We will show you ways how to learn, how to improve. There are so many resources out there, yeah, that can help you. Making sure that you can defend yourself. But it all starts with you as a developer taking a choice. Are you going to take the blue pill or are you going to take the red pill and see how deep the rabbit hole goes? Because guys, when you want to do proper security and security by design, you know, the devil's in the details. So you really need to go through all the way. You need to make the choice to be responsible for what you develop, that you have pride for it, that you develop, that not only works functional, yeah, and it works good and as intended, but it's also not hackable. And again, there are ways on how to accomplish this. And like I mentioned before, one of the most important things where it all starts with are your requirements. Yeah. What type of security requirements did you use and are you using when you're building an application? So here we have another great OWASP project, an open source project. It's called the ASVS. It stands for Application Security Verification Standard. It's a standard that's around 10 years old, used by military, government, financial, medical, healthcare, like all those institutes use it. And good thing is they also have different levels. So if you're just starting, yeah, and you want to improve your security, you start with level one. Are you like a bank or, you know, you need to create a really critical application? Then I would advise to already start with the level three. But here you already have the right set of security requirements for you to use, yeah, and be aware of what you need to do and implement to build a secure application. So, and the next step you can do as a developer is, for example, using the Security Knowledge Framework. It's again an open source project ready for use for you to use in your guide to secure programming. And again, it's about building an application secure by design because you have the right set of security requirements up front. There's awareness with you as a developer what you have to take into consideration when you're building certain type of applications or functionality. And the cool thing about this, it's all open source and it's clear and transparent. You know, you can see exactly or modify or change it to the needs that you want to. So it's really an added value on how to build applications by design secure. And the whole idea is of the security knowledge framework, the security controls and the requirements and stuff like that, that you, as a NEO, yeah, as a developer, you can see there are no surprises anymore. You know exactly where those agents are. So I talked a bit about the SKF project. Like I mentioned, it's an OWASP project, and I want to do a quick demonstration of the Security Knowledge Framework to show you guys how it can benefit you in your day-to-day development process. Here, I just log into the application. I'm running it in a Docker at the moment in my laptop. You can also install it on-premise or whatever suits you. As you can see here, this is the landing page of the Security Knowledge Framework, and it can help you developers in a couple of different ways. So basically, it's a central place where all information about security is correlated and stored in one place. So we talked about the ASVS, the Application Security Verification Standard. It's being used as a security control. And here we have the different ones. You also have for mobile, but for this, I will just show you for the web application. And as you can see, the security controls are built up using different categories. So you have architecture and CAD modeling. And with that, there's a security control. For example, the first one, verify that all application components are identified and are known to be needed. You can also click on it. It will give you a bit more insight about what the exact problem is and also the solution for the developer to approach this. We have security controls in the ASVS for the authentication. You have security controls for session management, access control, input handling, cryptography address, error handling, data protection, communication, HTTP security. Well, as you can see, a lot of the things are in there, even items related to business logic. This is just the level one. Of course, we also have the level three. Remember when I said when you're really building critical applications, let's say banking applications, well, then you want to go for the level three. And the level three consists of around 170 different types of security controls. And you can use this checklist in the security knowledge framework just to have an idea and to help yourself again what type of things you need to implement and take care of when you're building an application. So if you change something about authentication, you can have a look and a glance here if you indeed thought and are aware of all the possible things you should have done when building a critical application. So this is nice as a guidance to look some information up, like what type of security controls you should implement. Then one of the other core functionalities of SKF is that you have a knowledge base section. So in here you have a huge database of known attack vectors or possible things that can go wrong or you have to do. So personal identifiable information protection. So use SSL and TLS and store sensitive information encrypted. XML attacks, what it is. And again, the solution. So here we say also have a look at those type of knowledge base items because it's way more than only this knowledge base. Because as you can see, we have a couple of different type of XML injections that can occur. Again, a super detailed and list that if you have a type of vulnerability, you want to know more information and also the approach you should take as a developer, then you can look it up into the knowledge base. Like I mentioned a couple of times, the devil is really in the details. So we also have for different code languages, like around 40 written code examples, where we really want to show you, the developer, how to approach it on a program level. Really detailed with a lot of documentation and commenting, as you can see, why we do a certain thing, why we do, why we would do it, why we don't do it, really to give you the information and details that you need. So here, how you successfully generate a secure random cross-site request forgery token, and why we do certain things that you need to load invalid token, you destroy and start the session correctly, you die the whole session if the token is not valid. Again, really detailed information how to approach it. We also have different languages. So we have Java code examples, we have .NET, we have Python, we have Flask. Again, for you, for the developer, to have a look if you need some guidance on programming level, how to approach a certain type of, like input validation control or file upload functionality. So we try to put as much as possible the known functionality you need as a developer, as a code example in the security knowledge framework. So you have the checklist for your nice reference. And get information about the security controls. We have the knowledge where you can request information on the spot about certain type of attack vectors, and we have the code where you can look in a detailed way how to implement certain type of security controls or build secure functionality. The last step is that we can also use the security knowledge framework. You guys can use it to really get the right awareness before you start writing applications. So it's an awareness tool. You simply just say what type of level you want to have the security controls for, and you can create your project that you want to start building. So let's say we're building a new project. We give here the project name, amazing new project. It's the first version, so it's version 1.0. We give the description of the project, and then we have a couple of questions being asked. So based on these questions, we will filter the right security controls from the ASVS, because no developer wants to go through the whole 170 different type of security controls. So with this project and with this flow I'm just showing you, we will filter down to the exact security controls you need to be aware of when you're building a new application or adding features to your application. So basically, if you say yes or no, it will add or remove security controls from the ASVS. So here we have a sprint. Well, this is the first sprint. We're gonna add the basic stuff to this sprint for our new project. And here again, we have a couple of questions, and based on the questions that we have here, if we say yes or we say no, it will include or exclude certain security controls from the ASVS. So for now, we just say no, we save it. And now the security knowledge framework is gathering all the required security controls you need to implement and take care of when you're building a new application. So we have now 59 open items that we need to review and do something with. So all these items you need to implement and build into your application or do to make sure it's really secure. So before you're starting writing code, you already have now the right set of security controls that you need to implement. You can click on it. So here it says this control verify that all application components are identified and known to be needed. So what is the idea here? You identify all the application components. When you're building an application, you first want to map where you're placing the source files, libraries, executables. So it gives you a bit more in-depth knowledge. And you can say with status, yes, we did. Or you can say, no, we didn't, but we accept the risk. Just an idea. You can use it. As you can see, it's now put here, and you go through all the items. For your first project, for the first time you do this project and you use this. So for the first time, you will fill in the questions. It will give you a lot of results. As you saw, it are like 59 type of items. Well, now we have 58 because we have one closed item. So it's still quite a lot of security controls you need to implement. But please be aware, this is only the first time, because a lot of things you need to set up once correctly at the beginning of your application when you build the application, and then you benefited from it for every other sprint and iteration you do over your project. So if you now would say, let's say we created our first sprint, we did all the security controls, we released our project into production. Now we're in the next sprint, we want to add new functionality to it. So we say sprint 2, add, upload picture of user account. Yeah, that is the new feature we're going to release in this sprint. Then we answer a couple of questions. And for this one, we say, we implemented what you see is what you get editor. We say yes. All the other things we didn't do, we only did that. So we save. And now again, from all the 170 security controls, only the right ones that you need to be aware of are now selected for you. And as you can see, now you only have 8 security controls. And why 8? Because some of the security controls, they will always come back. For every release you do, you have to verify it. So for example, one of those items is verify there are no default passwords in use for the application framework or any other components used by the application. So this is an item that will always come back, just like a couple of others, like the verify that the runtime environment is not susceptible to buffer overflows. So you still have a couple of security controls, but again, some come always back because they're really important for every release. But as you see, now you are aware upfront what the security controls are, and you are aware when you're now building the code and the feature in your application that you will build it already from the start secure by design. So the Security Knowledge Framework is an OWASP project. It's free to use. You can use it extensively, like I showed you. You can only use the checklist if you want, or the knowledge base, or the code examples. It's all up to you how to utilize it. You can go full, or you can just use a tiny part of it. But it's there. It's there for you guys to use and to help to build secure applications by design. And why is it so important? Why am I telling this? Because you now have the skills and the insight, the awareness. You now have a truly effective means to build secure applications. Because remember when we stated, when I started the whole webinar with the question I gave to you, how do we solve the problem we have with SecDevOps? How can you still be secure and building secure applications when you are releasing 10 or 20 times a day? Because the problem is also, like I mentioned in the talk, with all the tools, that they only have a small percentage of coverage. Yeah. The other problem is that they take very long time for them to run and to produce output. When they do produce output, you still need to go manually through it, yeah, and verify if it's a false positive or a true positive. And again, it's all good, it's all fine, it adds value, so you should definitely do it. But to close that gap, yeah, from 20% coverage to, let's say, 99% coverage, it is you, the developer, the most awesome person, yeah, who can fix that issue by having the right security awareness, having the right security level, yeah, becoming from a starting Neo who needed to dodge bullets to now to Neo who can fight against the agents and be awesome and change the world. Yeah, you guys have now the skills. You guys don't have to dodge bullets. Yeah, you are the one. You can just simply stop the bullets because you are Neo. You are the solution to the problem we have to become truly effective in SecDevOps. And how to implement your security in that is by becoming the one. And again, one thing is really important. If you see somebody struggling in your team, help that person. Yeah, share security knowledge, share these awesome principles and tooling. Really be an advocate, because you are only as strong as the weakest developer in your team. If somebody in the team doesn't get certain security concepts or design principles, please teach them. Because if they pick up a feature, a change, and they are not aware, again, you have a big issue. You need to do this together as a team, have a way of working that everybody wants to do and stands behind. And yeah, that's the only way to really build secure applications, you know, by design. So help each other, share the knowledge you have, and make sure you all become awesome Neos who are going to save the world and be truly the only solution for the challenges that are ahead of us. I thank you guys very much. I thank you all very much for listening to me. If you have any questions, I'm happily here to answer. And I hope you enjoyed my talk. Thank you very much.